thanks for joining me for our December show of photography online. Let's go. Coming up on this month's show, we field test the Canon R5 and R6 cameras, we showcase the finalists in Scotland's Photo of the Year, we give you a few ideas for what to get the photographer who has everything, and we take you behind the scenes of the making of photography online. Welcome to the December episode of Photography Online, which is being sponsored by Surfshark VPN. A VPN is a virtual private network which allows you to connect to the internet via an encrypted tunnel which maintains your online privacy and protects your sensitive data. We'll be telling you more about that soon, but I've got a slightly different format for you today as we celebrate our first full year of Photography Online. So in this box are 10 gifts worth over £1,000, including a tripod, monopod, memory card, sensor cleaning kit, filter holder, and much more too. And even though it's our birthday, you're the ones who are going to be getting these gifts. One of the prizes is this Patterson Film Developing Starter Kit, which contains everything you need to develop a roll of black and white film at home. So to be in with a chance of winning one of the 10 prizes, not necessarily this one, all you need to do is keep an eye out for this box making an appearance somewhere in the show. When you see it, take a note of the time it appears on the screen and go to the competition link below to enter your answer. Don't reveal the answer in the comments section though, otherwise you're basically reducing your own chances of being a winner. All right, well, let's get things off and running with a look at two of the biggest new camera releases of 2020, the Canon R5 and R6.
So this here is the Canon R6.
Right.
And I think this might be the answer to what we've been looking for a video camera to record the show on.
Okay.
Have a feel of it. It's...
Yeah, it's smaller in the hand, but it's you know, still a weight to it. I'm assuming that's the lens.
Yeah, so what I thought we would do is set up a couple of scenarios for what we typically do, and we'll shoot them on what we normally use, which is the 5D Mark IV. And we know what the limitations are with that. And then we'll shoot exactly the same on this, and we'll see what the difference is.
Yeah.
So as you know, when we use the 5D Mark IV, we normally use it, if we're hand holding it, we normally use it on this, and
yeah.
I know you hate this with a vengeance, and putting the camera on and off of it and balancing it and everything, it all takes time. But that theoretically negates this because it's inbuilt.
No, that would be good.
So theoretically, that should be as good, if not better.
Well, this is the story of what I had for breakfast this morning. It started very
As you can see, an unstabilized camera is unsuitable for walking shots as the footage is simply too shaky. This is just so you can see what difference a gimbal makes.
Okay, so here is the story of what I ate.
This is our standard setup, and hopefully you can see the difference. The addition of the gimbal makes the video smoother, but comes at the cost of extra weight and hassle. Here are the two versions side by side. If used with an image stabilized lens, the Canon R6 has three different stabilization modes, which, when combined, look like this. Smooth video simply by hand holding the camera.
Toaster had some butter on there, and yes, I had a Twix. I'm regretting it now.
And now the R6 at the same time as the 5D Mark IV with the gimbal.
Another advantage is that records 4K at 50 frames a second.
Whereas, zoom in even closer.
Yes, but we can also do slow-mo stuff. So who's going to do the running down the hill in slow motion, me or you?
Yeah, you can go for it.
Yeah, I thought you might say that.
Let's just hold that for a second, shall we? As you can see, this is proof that no matter how good the camera equipment, the importance of an attractive subject is still key. Okay, carry on.
And the other thing that this has got theoretically advantage over the 5D Mark IV is, you know how the 5D Mark IV sometimes hunts when
yes.
you put it in autofocus?
Yeah.
And then you get a clip that you just can't use because it's suddenly gone out of focus. This has much better eye detection focus.
We tried to shake off the autofocus on the R6 by changing the distance and the position of the subject within the frame. but it kept locked on with a much better accuracy than we're used to with the 5D Mark IV. Another area where the R6 has an advantage is in the dynamic range of its video. Often, when we are recording with a bright background, we have to blow out all the highlights, as these are well outside the range of the 5D Mark IV for video purposes. As you can see in these two comparisons, there's more detail in the sky from the R6 file. On top of this, the R6 has the option to record in C-Log, which increases the dynamic range further still, but the files do need a lot more editing to get them to look as punchy as the standard output files.
What do you reckon then?
I really like it. I like the feel of it. It's a good size in my hand anyway. I like the fact, again, like I said about other cameras, all the buttons are on the top. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that's a really, really great feature. And the stabilization is actually excellent.
Well, that's the main thing.
That is the main thing.
That was the reason that we've been looking for another camera, so that we don't have to use that gimbal thing, because it's eliminating hassle and it's eliminating the amount of gear that you take out. And I know that you always struggle to hold it.
Basically what you're saying is I have no muscles.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly.
Well, it's true, but no, I really like this and it gets my vote.
I mean, I don't know why they use David Hasselhoff, to be honest. They could have just used me.
Hasselhoff,
I'm cheaper.
His job is safe.
Thanks.
We'll be looking at the big brother to the R6, the R5, in just a moment. But before we do that, as I mentioned before, the show is sponsored by Surfshark VPN. So to tell us a bit more and why it might be useful to you, here's Harry.
If you're not sure what a VPN is, then Surfshark is going to be right up your street.
VPNs help keep you safe while you're browsing online, whether you're at home, on public Wi-Fi, or, as we regularly do, traveling abroad.
If, like us, you're concerned about your online identity, data theft and hacking, then Surfshark is going to help to keep you protected online.
One of the biggest benefits for me is blocking those annoying pop-up ads that seem to appear on every website these days. Surfshark's clean web feature means I know I'm protected from malware, targeting and even those dodgy internet scams. As a working photographer, I tend to upload large amounts of data, big fat image and video files. Using a VPN helps to protect this critical information, plus gives you that always welcome peace of mind.
Surfshark is the only service that lets you connect an unlimited amount of devices using a single membership. That means you can keep all of your devices protected, from your desktop computers to your laptops, tablets and your phones.
Surfshark VPN is dead simple to set up and has got to be the best value service out there. If you want to give it a go, you can use the code photography to get a whopping 84% off plus 4 extra months for free. There's a 30-day money-back guarantee, so you really have nothing to lose. Get yourself protected online now using the links in the description below.
I'm sure that'll be useful to many of you. In just a moment, we're going to be joining photographer James Brew to find out about the photographic highlight of his year, photographing the Comet Neowise. But right now, let's go back to Harry as he tells us about the Canon R5.
Unlike some members of our team, I embrace new technology. When Canon's first full-frame mirrorless came out, the EOS R, I was first in line to pick one up. Now, it does most jobs really quite well, but it was never advertised or marketed as a wildlife camera, so I would often defer back to the 5D Mark IV with its better autofocusing capabilities. Now, we have a new offering, the R5, and on paper, it's a huge step up in all respects. I've been playing around to see if it fills that crucial gap for me. As a mirrorless camera, the R5 has an electronic viewfinder, of course. This isn't going to be for everyone. I'm not thinking of anyone in particular, of course. But for me, it's an absolute advantage. It significantly sped up my workflow, and the viewfinder on the R5 is a step up from that on the EOS R. If you own a digital SLR like the 5D Mark IV, then you'll be familiar with the clunk of the mirror going up and down every time you take an image. Even switching this into its silent shooting mode does not do much to dampen the noise. I've noticed that even the standard shutter mode on the R5 is quieter, not only to that of the Mark IV, of course, but the EOS R. Then, if you want true silent shooting, you've got it. This makes an enormous difference when shooting sensitive wildlife, whereas I would have to take an image, wait, and judge any reaction to the sound while using an SLR. With the R5, I can shoot hundreds of images without ever worrying about disturbing my subject. From noise to noise. High ISO performance is a key consideration for any wildlife photographer, especially in places like Scotland, where quite often we're photographing in dim or overcast conditions. Capturing an image on ISO 5000 or even 8000 is not uncommon. The 5D Mark IV has always been fantastic at dealing with high levels of noise. Take the R5, however, and even though it has high resolution at 45 megapixels, its ability to capture detail in the shadows and the darks while minimizing noise level is pretty astounding. I really thought the larger megapixel count was going to hold it back, but I'm happy to be wrong on this. I'm always on the lookout for advancements in autofocus technology. I think it's one of the most exciting areas of photography. So when the R5 was announced, it mostly made headlines for its video capabilities, but it was the autofocus I really wanted to test out. So one of the most exciting features I was keen to play around with is the Animal Eye Detect autofocus. This has made an appearance on cameras from other brands in the past, but I think the one that appears here on the Canon is a massive step up. It could easily detect insects from a distance when they were static and when they began flying around, as well as all manner of other subjects. I did try it with one of my classic subjects, eagles in flight, and it did have a little difficulty. But this is one of the biggest autofocus challenges out there. Fast moving birds, complicated and very changeable backgrounds, low contrast, it really isn't easy. Once locked on though, it holds and tracks birds really well. Now, I haven't had long to play around with this function, so undoubtedly there's an element of familiarity and practice which is going to help. Plus, learning what situations it deals with and knowing when to switch to traditional autofocus. Talking of which, there's not much to say about the autofocus other than that it's pretty astonishing. I think it's possibly the best focus I've used on any camera. It nailed everything I threw at it, and you can't ask much more of that. So this is my EOS R. Would I get rid of this and go and pick up an R5? You betcha.
It's good to see Harry throwing stuff again. Thankfully though, it wasn't one of the cameras lent to us by Canon. So let's face it, unless you're in the Perspex industry, 2020 hasn't been the best year for many of us. Some people have been affected more than others with the global pandemic situation, and if you're at the wrong end of the scale, then you certainly have my sympathies. When we launched Photography Online at the beginning of this year, we had exciting plans to bring you features from places like China, Spain and other far-flung locations, but these are all on hold at the moment. Rest assured though, we will be bringing you such features in the future, but we can only do so once it's practical and safe to travel again. So you've had to put up with a lot of Scotland on the show, but hey, what's wrong with that? Despite the restrictions, there have been some notable highlights of the year from the team, so let's see what their most memorable photo moments were. First up is James Brew, who took a photo which is literally out of this world.
In 1997, at the ripe old age of 11, I vividly remember looking up into the night sky and seeing Hale-Bopp Comet. It really left a lasting impression on me, and I've not seen anything like it since. Now, 23 years later, I'm hoping to reignite this magical childhood memory and photograph the latest comet superstar, Comet Neowise. So filled with a mixture of excitement and anticipation, I jumped into my car and made my way to a local dark skies area, which with a bit of luck would provide incredible photographic potential. So this is the location where I hope to be shooting Comet Neowise a little bit later on. It's called the Point of Air, and it's the most northerly tip of the Isle of Man, and it's a personal astrophotography hotspot and favourite of mine for many reasons. Firstly, you've got a clear, unobscured view of the northern skies here. You've got little to no light pollution whatsoever. And most importantly, this beautiful little lighthouse that you can see over here in the background is called Winky Lighthouse, and it just sits perfectly alone on this shingle beach here, and it just makes for an absolutely amazing astrophotography foreground subject. Now, in theory, the comet should, at its lowest position in the sky when it's 12 to 13 degrees above the horizon line, should sit perfectly above the lighthouse here, which currently I'm kind of sat to the south of the lighthouse, and this is looking perfectly north here, and there's an empty clear sky behind it. Well, there's a few clouds in it at the moment, but hopefully there's going to be a clear sky. And from here I've got a perfect shooting angle back to that lighthouse, with hopefully the comet shining beautifully just above it. Now, if I go in close to the lighthouse behind me here and try to shoot it wide angle, it's going to make the lighthouse look big and impressive, but the comet is going to look absolutely piddly and pathetic. It's going to look like a tiny, tiny smudge in the sky behind it. Just not gonna work. Telephoto is the way to go when shooting this, and that's because it increases the size of the comet in respect to the foreground object, which is the lighthouse here. I can see the comet, it looks amazing. I can't emphasize how incredible it looks. It is beautiful. When I first started to see it, it was about maybe 11:15, around that sort of time, and honestly it looked quite underwhelming. It just looked like a little smudge in the sky. But as the light levels have decreased, the tail has just grown in size, and it's just become so striking, and it looks absolutely amazing. It really does. That tail is massively long. It's so much longer than I anticipated. I'm shooting much wider. I'm currently at 70 mils, which is far wider than I anticipated, just to get that tail in at the top of the frame. It is absolutely beautiful, and it's one of the best things I've ever seen in photography, or yeah, in my life. It's incredible. It really, really is. And I feel absolutely privileged to be here shooting it. I just hope I do it justice. So I'm gonna have to wrap this up as soon as possible, because we're really getting to the crunch time now. We're at the darkest period, and the comet is gonna be at its optimum position above that lighthouse. So I cannot mess this up. But I'll just quickly show you an image on the back of the camera. Just dial down the exposure here. That is what we're talking about there. I mean, it looks insanely good on the back of the LCD, so I can't wait to see this. What an experience. Needless to say, I'm absolutely delighted with this image. Neowise really surpassed all my expectations with its long dual tails clearly on display. As the comet approached its lowest position in the sky, it literally pointed straight down to the tip of the lighthouse, providing a wonderful synergy between both halves of the image. Given the scarcity of bright comets, its near perfect positioning in the sky, and the temperamental nature of Isle of Man weather, I feel this is potentially one of those once in a lifetime images. Just incredible. I feel so very thankful to have had the opportunity to witness it, and I hope I've been able to share a little bit of the magic with you all too. But alas, we have come to the end, and I need to catch up on some sleep. So thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you all again soon.
We've recently done a couple of features all about the importance of planning your photos, and James's shot there is a testament to how important that is. The last thing you want to be doing as a photographer is running around like a headless chicken, not knowing what to shoot. A little later on in the show, I'll be catching up with the other experts to hear about their photographic highlights of the year. But first, let me show you a couple more items which are in this box of goodies. We've got a visible dust sensor cleaning kit. Case filters have thrown in some phone lenses and this wide angle filter holder. There's also a King Joy ball head and this walk stool, which I might try to keep for myself as it looks like the kind of thing that I could do with. All in all, the value of prizes here is over £1,000, so it's well worth entering if you know the answer. But shh, don't reveal it in the comments. I'll be picking out 10 winners from the list of correct entries and we'll be assigning a prize for each one at random. Now, on the subject of presents, and with Christmas fast approaching, you may be struggling to think of something to buy as a gift for a friend or family member who is one of those really annoying people who, whenever they need something, they just go out and buy it for themselves. This is never truer than with photographers, but fear not, help is at hand. Ford's Photographic is one of the UK's biggest camera retailers, so what better place to go for advice on what I can buy for difficult photographers at Christmas? Based in the Highlands of Scotland and known locally as the Toy Shop, it has an enormous range of both new and quality used equipment, all overseen by a team of friendly and knowledgeable staff. Hello.
Hi there, can I help you?
Yeah, I'm just looking for some ideas really. Christmas is coming up and I have, you know, a photographer in my life who just seems to go out and buy whatever he needs. So I just thought I'd come into the toy shop and just, you know, have a wander. Do you have any ideas of kind of maybe things that everybody would
things.
Like?
Yeah, we've got some good things that we can show you.
Absolutely, that's great. Ooh, a torch.
So, a nice torch. So it does a couple of different things. If you press it once, it'll switch on.
Mm-hmm.
Press it again, it will be a wee bit brighter than what it was. And then if you press it down and hold the button, it will heat up the stem of the torch, and that will last up to 6 hours at 45 degrees temperature.
I could feel that getting warmer. So theoretically, if they're going out and about in the morning, early morning, trying to catch a sunrise, yep. They need a torch anyway. So this keeps their hands warm at the same time.
Well, need to have your trigger finger always warm to make sure you catch a
fantastic.
That right picture.
And how long would that last?
So it's best to heat it up to the full temperature and then switch it off and it'll just kind of keep warm mm-hmm. for up to 4 hours.
So you could keep it in your pocket as well.
Keep it in your pocket for that time. You've also got a few other options on the back of it. You've got two USB ports. So you can actually add a couple of accessories on.
I have seen it all now, a torch with a USB port.
So you plug your USB port in. So you can either charge your phone from it, and it lights up to tell you it's charging.
So light, heat and power.
Or you can charge your camera through it.
Oh, wow.
So if you just need that extra bit of power just to charge up for the last picture.
That might fit Harry's hand, I'm thinking. But yeah, brilliant. So. Fantastic. Yeah, no, that's a really nice option. Oh, what else do you think?
We've got some nice straps from Peak Design.
Can't go wrong with straps.
These are a good, quick and easy strap system. So the good thing about it is it's quite easy to fit. You just loop it onto your camera through that way.
Well, that would actually be ideal for Marcus. Anything that can reduce extra faff.
And it's quite easy to clip in.
Now that is handy because I quite often wear the strap, but I'm always getting told take the strap off. It gets in the way, and it's quite a faff to do normally.
Yeah,
so
nice,
that's
nice
quite
and quickly
nifty.
To do.
Yeah.
What else we got? If you're out in the wilds and you want to kind of...
You want to hide from other photographers?
Hide from other people?
From your wildlife?
Covers yourself.
Oh, and it's got
covers your camera gear.
Face hole.
And a face hole to go with it. So it's a bit like a hide.
Yeah,
but
it's just a
portable hide. So you just throw it over the top.
And you can walk around wearing it.
Walk around wearing it.
That could improve the appearance of some of the photographers I know.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's a really fun idea. I like that. So if I was, you know, feeling quite flush at Christmas and feeling quite generous, do you have anything maybe at the kind of higher end of the scale that most photographers you think might appreciate?
Yeah, I mean, everyone likes a nice bit of Leica and a bit of Billingham to go with it. So we have a nice Billingham bag, nice and compact.
Nice and simple.
Doesn't look like a camera bag either.
No.
And you've got a nice new Leica camera body. It's a monochrome, so it only shoots black and white.
Really?
And it's the new Leitz Wetzler edition.
Wow, very nice. Nick loves a bit of black and white, actually. I know he'd really appreciate that.
May I ask, how much is this going
for? That's £7,400.
Okay, then. It's beautiful.
How many do you want?
Yeah, well, I'll get back to you on that one. But that's a stunning camera. And the bag, really liking this bag because, like as you say, it's simple. Like, everybody would appreciate that. Very nice looking, actually.
If you want something really special and you've got something really different.
More so.
We've got a number plate for a car. that says photo on it, PH10TOZ, photos.
My goodness, that's not the kind of thing I expected to come in and be expecting to buy. Can I ask how much that's going for?
It's going to be a couple of £1,000.
All right then. Well, I think I'll get saving on that. Speaking of saving, do you have anything at the kind of maybe more super budget side of the range?
Hope they like them.
Thank you, I'm sure you will. Hello.
Oh, so you've been shopping then, have you?
I have, actually. I've been down at Bars, just trying to do some Christmas
shopping.
What
have you bought me?
Well, oh, that does remind me, actually. Yeah, I did pick something up for you guys.
Oh, no, this could be a big box.
One for you.
Cheers.
And Marcus, I'm sure I got you something as well. Oh, aye. Marcus.
Well, I was getting really excited by the size of the box.
There you go. Yeah. It's really hard to do Christmas shopping for photographers, but my dad's going to love this.
Okay, yeah. Thanks, Ruth.
All right, see you guys. If you're looking for the perfect stocking filler this Christmas, then this could be just the thing. It's our Essential Camera Skills Manual. It's crammed full of 68 pages of information and top tips from the photography online experts, and it's designed to be kept in your camera bag for instant access to all the information that you're likely to need to get the best out of a situation. It covers landscapes, wildlife, portraits, as well as all the foundational topics such as depth of field, focusing, exposure, and composition. It's priced at just £12.50, and it's cheaper, but just as good as having one of the experts with you. In fact, I would say it's much preferred. It's available in both physical and digital versions, but if you're thinking of a Christmas gift, then the physical copy is the way to go. As always, there's a link in the video description below. So, talking of gifts, this Bembo tripod is one of the amazing prizes in the box of goodies which we're giving away to celebrate our first anniversary. Not only does the unique design allow better options for macro photography when you need to get close up to your subject, but it's also fully water sealed, so the first leg joint can be used even in the sea without worrying about cleaning all the salt from the joints. I've also got a monopod version to give away too, and along with all the other items, this box is worth over £1,000. If you want to be in with a chance of being one of our 10 winners, you know what to do. Now, last month saw the deadline for entries into Scotland's Photo of the Year, and I was honoured to be invited onto the judging panel. Along with the other judges, it was great looking through all the entries, so thank you so much to everybody that took part. This is a non-profit making competition dedicated to helping local charities, so if you weren't successful in getting your photo into the final stages, you can still feel good that you helped contribute to some worthy causes. I thought you might like to take a look at some of the entries as well as the judging process in selecting the final. So I caught up with the other two judges to see if we could agree on the final top 10 photos.
Yeah, love it. I love the drama in this shot, and it kind of screams Scotland as well. You know, Old Manor Store there, the cathedral. Technically, it's pretty much bang on. And I felt like there was a load of energy that was still retained in the image. So the snowflakes, the shutter speed that's been chosen has been fast enough to retain the snowflakes so that you still get that sense it's not just the white out of the snow on the rocks, you know, you can still see it falling.
Okay, so next up is this shot from David Ball. It's another winter scene. Alex, where's this one?
So this is in Glencoe, and it's just beside Buckleletive Moor. It's a, you know, it's a scene that you can pass and you see it from the road, but I really love how big that they've made the mountain in this compared to the cottage. And of course, the light is just beautiful. But the really soft touch with the editing, you know, it's a really nice light image. It's lovely.
Yeah, no, I agree. So moving on to this beautiful scene from Steve Morrison, what do you think, Alex?
Yeah, it's a beautiful image. Again, it's sort of transported me there straight away. It looks like morning time, I'm guessing. It's just lovely soft light. The leading lines going in and all the just the lovely glow on the trees. And then in the background, you've got the fog, which just adds so much three dimension to it.
It's the light. The light's so beautiful, and it's the sort of one that you can imagine if you were stood there, you'd be going pretty crazy, trying different lenses. You know, like you'd be getting very excited by the light. You'd just be like, you just nailed it, you know?
Yeah, I know what you mean. It's definitely one of my favorites, as is this actually from Bianca Blanc. And it doesn't necessarily scream Scotland, but Adam, I know you really like this one.
Absolutely. This was one of the jaw-dropping ones for me when I saw this one. And that did kind of cross my mind, Scotland Photo of the Year. You know, does it fit the brief, as it were? But it's so strong an image. I love the composition as well, you know, the placement in the top right corner there. And just the technique. I mean, like, you can almost touch the hairs on that. It's incredible.
The same for me. It just stood out straight away as I was looking through even just the thumbnails. You know, you could just see the eyes, even though it was such a small image.
Yes.
And yeah, it's just the expression on its face and the fact it's like hunkered down.
So the next finalist is Derek Baumgartner with this dramatic shot on Glencoe. I know this one really jumped out for you, Alex.
It grabbed me because of, I mean, the water, the texture in the water is really well done. You know, it's just enough motion, but it's got some really nice texture still in there as well. But this tends to be how it looks when you just walk up there. You know, they've not gone crazy with any editing. Yeah, it's just, again, it just kind of transported me to how it is when you go there, so.
Adam?
I love so much about this image. It screams Scotland for starters. The conditions are what you think of when you're driving through Glencoe. You know, that's most of the time, that's kind of what it looks like. Sort of low-lying clouds. And again, the editing and processing that's been done has been done very tastefully.
Okay, so moving on to this fantastic capture by Frank Hyman of a white-tailed eagle. This is certainly a striking image, isn't it, Adam?
I mean, that's such a great capture. That was another one of those wow moments for me when I saw it. And quite often what I find with wildlife photography is that you can capture an image like that, a subject, but not in the right light. You know, you quite often see images of wildlife in less than ideal light, but the actual subject's incredible. Whereas here, it feels like everything's come together. The light on the wings is just beautiful. You know, you can almost touch that.
All right, well, next we have this photo from Jason Hudson. I think you initially spotted this one, Alex.
Yeah, so it was me that picked it. It just stood out. You know, I went past it and I kept going back to it. One thing I think I wrote in the notes is you can hear the wind in it. So it's really dramatic. I love the fact that they've put it into monochrome and just simplified it all. But yeah, it's just got so much energy and mood. I love it.
And also the processing hasn't been overdone at all, which it's so easy to do, like particularly with black and white, you know, make lots of the blacks really black kind of thing, whereas it feels really balanced. And again, I like the leading line, you know, the ridge of the mountain there kind of pulls you in to the top of the mountain, then it's obscured by the storm that's coming in. So it's a great image.
Yeah, I really like this black and white, actually. Next up is this shot from Karen Lahr, and this is a scene I know really well, actually. It's just out the back of my home.
One thing that really stood out to me with this image is because I have seen the road included in this kind of scene before, but not done like this. So the road is so far on the left and at the bottom of the image. It just kind of curves round and then your eye sort of follows it all the way up. And it just seems like the old man of Stor is so far away and it takes your eye a while to get there.
Yeah.
You know?
And that's precisely what happened to my eye when I first saw it, I saw the road and then followed it. And then suddenly I saw the old man of Stor. So it really draws you in, this one.
So moving closer to you this time, Adam, with this scene from Tim Hodges, which is taken from your stomping ground.
Yeah, there was a couple of images of the castle from this viewpoint, but this is the one that jumped out at me. It was just like the time that it had been taken, the blue tones. So that would be after sunset. What I really loved as well was that you have all the tungsten lights with the new buildings, but the castle sits proud, being kind of daylit tones. So it's kind of almost like between the old and the new there, where you have the castle really shining, massive spotlight on that, and then even the tungsten lights look really great against that as well. So it's just the tones that worked really for me.
Okay, so finally, but by no means least, is this shot from Stephen Dowris, another shot actually taken here on Sky. Adam, why don't you go first with this one?
I really like this shot. It's similar to the shot of Glencoe that we were looking at, because it just sums up the mood and the atmosphere of Scotland. It's one thing to capture Scotland in incredible light that happens once a year or something like that, or once every 5 years, or those kind of conditions, but it's another thing to capture it in a way that everyone is really familiar with.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a lovely image, and like Adam said, despite there being no sort of obvious direct light, the glow in all the colours, in the grasses and the heather is really nice.
Okay, so one last thing we need to discuss is the Judges' Merit Award, which we decided should go to this amazing shot of the Gannets diving, which stood out to all of us. I know you were particularly impressed, Alex, with the technical aspects of it.
I did instantly start thinking about how hard that must have been to take. You know, that's another level of commitment, you know.
In terms of a wildlife image, I mean, it ticks so many boxes. The light on the bird is stunning. I mean, that's so good. And I love the energy that's in the image. So on the, even though the bird is on the right hand side, kind of swimming out of frame as it were, there's still lots of energy on the left hand side of the frame with the bubbles that keeps your attention over there. So it doesn't feel like it's unbalanced in any way.
All right, fantastic. So that's our decisions made. It's going to be really interesting to see what the public vote for over the coming week. I guess we'll find out soon enough.
In case you're wondering which one was voted the winner, it was this one. But all top 10 finalists received cash prizes, so they were all winners. Scotland's Photo of the Year will be open again for entries in April, so if you missed out on this year's competition, make sure you get your photo sent in for the 2021 title. This year it raised over £800 for charity, and with your help, more can be raised next year. On the subject of 2021, this is our new calendar, which showcases the top 10 locations on Sky, which we've been counting down each month on the show. The Isle of Skye is where Photography Online is based, so we like to show off what it has to offer, and we couldn't think of a better way than to have its best views plastered over your wall for the entire year. In last month's show, we took you behind the scenes to show you how a couple of the shots were taken, and there are still a few copies left, so if you want one before they're all gone, do go to the relevant link in the video description. Now, unless you shoot exclusively with film, there are some things which every photographer needs in their bag. When it comes to memory, you don't want to be buying the cheap stuff. You want to ensure the safety of your photos. Delkin offer a lifetime guarantee on all their memory cards, and there are a couple in this box along with card readers. Hopefully you've been keeping an eye out for the item that we mentioned at the beginning of the show. It may or may not have appeared already. I'm not giving you any clues. Now, many of you have asked how we put this show together and to see what goes on behind the scenes. If you have an Instagram account, you can now follow us at Photography Online YouTube, where I post snapshots of what we're up to, so that's a good way to get an idea of what we're working on for future shows. Starting next month, we're going to be changing the format of Photography Online because, to be honest, the current format is so 2020 and we like to keep things fresh. I'll explain all about the new changes in a moment, but for those who are interested in how the show gets put together, here's a wee look behind the scenes. As you'll see, things don't always go according to plan. The first thing we do is brainstorm for ideas. We usually work from a list of literally hundreds of ideas, choosing the ones which we feel will best suit each specific episode. For example, there's no point in doing a feature about travel during a worldwide lockdown or about photographing Aurora in June. Once we've finalised the list of features for a show, we start storyboarding and scripting them. We don't film things without a clear idea of the structure, and this is one of the areas where we get great feedback that our content stands out from the crowd. Once we have a clear idea of all the footage that we need to get, we can start filming. This is typically done on a Canon 5D Mark IV, but as we mentioned earlier in the show, we have been on the lookout for something which can eliminate the requirement of a gimbal or a tripod, so this may change very soon to the Canon R6. Once we have all the footage recorded, we compile it all together and do a rough edit to get everything in the right place. This gives us an approximate duration for each feature, which we try to keep to around 6 minutes where possible. It also helps us to identify if there's anything missing. This can be important if it's a tutorial feature, as we need to make sure it's easy to follow for the lesser experienced viewers, but at the same time doesn't underwhelm the more advanced photographers who are watching. The next stage is adding music. This is Marcus's department, as his background is in music and radio production.
Most of our features are music driven, and this is what gives them their pace and atmosphere. Now, choosing the right music is very important, as if this is wrong, then the whole feature will fail. For example, look at these two versions of the same shot, one with suitable music and one where the music is wrong. We mostly use a platform called Epidemic Sound, but some of our music is custom written. More on that later. With the music dictating the flow of the feature, once the right music track has been chosen, it's now possible to do the main edit, as I know all the music junctions we need to hit at key points. We certainly don't just whack a bit of background music underneath and say, that'll do. This is another area which makes our content stand out from the crowd. It's more cinematic, almost as though the music has been composed for the feature itself, which sometimes it has. Now, getting everything to gel takes a lot of time, maybe adding more footage here and editing some out from there, or extending or shortening the music to fit. I've been known to spend days getting a 6 minute feature flowing exactly as I want it, and often I can't sleep until I know it's working exactly as it should.
The next stage is recording the narration, which is done at the local radio station, Radio Sky, where I've presented the breakfast show for many years. This is then added to the edit for the next stage, sound processing, so it's back to Marcus.
The sound processing is something which usually doesn't take that long, but that's only because I've been doing it for 30 years in a previous career. Learning about audio compression, limiters, expanders, parametric equalization, etc., isn't something which can be done quickly, so it makes sense to oversee this myself.
Once the sound has been done, it's back to me to take care of the colour correcting. This can be a tedious task, colour matching an hour's worth of video clips, most of which are just a second or two in duration. A typical show has around 1,500 individual video clips in it, and each one has to be colour matched. Next up, it's the graphics, which are done by Nick. Typically, we send him a sketch of what's needed, and he then creates a digital version which can be animated and used in the show. Now all the individual features are done, it's time to cement them all together with the links. This is where you see me introducing each feature and telling you about other related topics. The links are mostly scripted, as this ensures we get across the right information in the most concise manner without me rambling on. We try to vary the locations of where these are recorded, with each show having a theme. We did have plans to do shows from Spain and China this year, but sadly those trips got cancelled, so the furthest we got was Venice. Rest assured though that once travel restrictions are lifted, that we'll be heading further afield to bring you more content from outside of Scotland. With the links recorded, it's time for the final edit. This is where everything comes together and we add all the captions and theme music. On the subject of the theme music, this was composed especially for the show by Adam Booley, who, as well as being a pro photographer who we use for many of our trips, is also a musician. The original theme you've heard for 2020 has now been updated and you'll be hearing that from now on. All that's left to do now is to check the whole show through, but this can only be done once the show has been exported from the computer and uploaded to YouTube. This takes up to 12 hours per show, so it's usually done overnight. We then watch the entire show for any errors, and of course we always find them, so we then have to go back into the master, address the problem, and then re-export the whole show, which takes another 12 hours. Only once we've watched the whole show and are happy with it does it get approved for release. In addition to everything we've just explained, there's also prizes to organise, sponsors to coordinate, manufacturers to communicate with, so there's plenty more going on in the background all the time. Typically, we try to work a couple of months in advance, but of course, it's not unusual to find us up all night the day before the deadline, ironing out final issues and tweaks. Now, despite our best efforts, sometimes things don't go according to plan. This can be for a variety of reasons, such as eating while trying to talk.
Hope these...
Another potential problem is when you're trying to do something very demanding, such as walking. Sometimes it's the equipment which fails.
To shoot the sunrise and sunset on the same day, damn it, Marcus.
Then there are external elements which we have no control over.
It doesn't matter which camera you use, these will always give you.
Even I, a true pro, can get my tongue tied sometimes.
Now, every show we feature a quote of the month, and this month's is from Percy W. Harris, who once said, "Practice in photography is nothing to do with a quote."
And then there's the saying that if something can go wrong, it will go wrong.
Now, 50mm is known as a standard focal length because...
One thing Harry has learned is not to try to record a camera in the company of a group of mischievous workshop customers.
There's something magical about being up high in the mountains and watching the world come alive, you f***ing bastard.
Another lesson Harry's learned is to think about the words you're going to say before you actually say them.
To the sensor, apart from clean air. On the subject of blowing, we want...
Why did I say that?
Okay, take two.
I couldn't even get it out.
But by far the biggest cause of recording problems we faced in 2020 was from the local population of midges, tiny insects, which make it impossible to ignore them, no matter how hard you try.
All photos entered, and all proceeds go to local charities, so it is a worthy cause to get involved in. As always, full details are in the link section down below. All right, well, it's time for the section you've all been waiting for. We're welcoming onto the stage our star student, and in this month's episode of Schools Out, we're explaining the aperture scale, something which could... Oh my goodness.
Yeah, and particularly down the eastern seaboard of the US and North America. If anything washes up, then just check it's probably mine.
Yeah, it's identifiable. It's got your stickers on it.
Yeah, it's a black camera bag. Can't miss it.
All right, look out for that.
And before you comment why don't you use insect repellent, then you really don't understand the Highland midge. They laugh in the face of any repellent. So I hope that gives you a good insight into the huge amount of time and effort that we put into making sure each show reaches our very high standards. And so things are going to be changing a little for 2021, as well as an updated theme tune, new graphics and a shinier feel to the show. We've also got a few new features to unveil. The main change though is that we're going to be releasing 2 30-minute shows every month instead of a single 1 hour show. Each month will now be split into a part one and a part two, meaning you don't have to wait so long to get your photography online fix. 4 p.m. is still the release time, and a new show will be available on the second and final Sunday of every month. After a lot of thought, we've decided the show will remain free to watch, but you've just seen the amount of work which goes into our existing show, and our goal is to raise our standards even further so we can bring you a better variety of features from more locations. Doing so though requires some serious funding, so we're introducing a Photography Online supporters package which starts at just £2.99 a month. If you saw a photo magazine packed full of tutorials, gear reviews, location info and competitions, you probably wouldn't hesitate to buy it for £2.99, so we really hope that you'll help us keep the channel going by becoming a Photography Online supporter. All you need to do is hit the join button on our channel page, and you'll be able to check out the different tiers and the great perks that come along with being a supporter. You will need to do this on a computer, as the join button doesn't appear on a phone, tablet or TV unless you enable the desktop mode. The more we can invest back into the show, the better the product we can create for you, which I think is exactly what we all want. So, what can you expect in the new show? Well, we'll be keeping some of the more popular features from 2020 and introducing some exciting new ones too. on location follows a pro photographer to get an insight into their work. Essential Camera Skills covers everything you need to know about using your camera to get great shots. Kit Corner is where we test and review new, current, vintage and quirky gear. Surgery, where we critique and edit your images and answer your questions. Analog Affairs is for lovers of film cameras from 35mm to large format, but still covers generic skills, which are useful for any kind of photography. Mission Possible, where we attempt to capture ambitious photo ideas. Digital Darkroom is where we'll be covering post-production skills. Wild Diaries, an exciting new monthly journal showing how you can photograph local wildlife and nature. The Subject Project, a new feature showcasing a specific subject and then inviting you to shoot it. Just the Two of Us is where we'll take you along with one of the show's experts on a vlog-style shoot. Location Discovered, where we showcase amazing and often unknown photo locations. Plus, we'll also have more team challenges, special features, competitions, and much, much more. So I hope you'll agree that's worth supporting us for as little as $2.99. I really hope you consider helping us so we can bring you all this exciting content in the months to come. Now, earlier on in the show, we saw James Brew's photo highlight of 2020 with his amazing shot of Comet Neowise. Next up to tell us about another photographic highlight of the year is Harry Martin, who made a new friend a little closer to home.
Much of my free time is spent tracking down and watching some of Skye's amazing wildlife. So this can range from golden eagles up high on our mountains to seals or shorebirds. Having a bit more free time than usual this year, I utilise that to try and explore all the patches of coastline that I've been meaning to for 6 years or so now, in search of one of our more elusive residents, the otter. Now, you can find otters pretty much anywhere along the west coast of Scotland, but finding locations that are readily and safely accessible with reliable and predictable otters is a pretty hard combination to come by. So after hundreds of hours across a good few sites, I found somewhere with a good bit of promise really, leading to what has to be my photographic highlight of the year. So while walking my particular chosen patch of coastline, laden down with the 500mm lens just in case, I spotted something in the distance, and it turned out to be an otter a few hundred metres further along, and I thought, oh, what luck. It was only my second time visiting this particular area, so I really thought luck was on my side. I began stalking a little bit closer towards where the otter was feeding, and as I got closer, I heard the unmistakable squeak of an otter cub, quickly followed by a second squeak. Now, my heart really started to pound at this point, because finding otter cubs is always really exciting. They offer really good opportunities for photography. So a bit of careful stalking and predicting what the family would do eventually saw me nestled into a seaweed-filled crevice with all three otters less than, I reckon, about 15 metres or so in front of me. I spent probably about 2.5 hours contorted in between the rocks, watching them roll around and play, as well as a fourth otter making an appearance and joining in the fun as well. And the activity really peaked when the two cubs began running to and from the water, rolling around and playing. Focus was a real nightmare in that situation, so I resorted to manually focusing through the viewfinder, as every so often the head would just pop up above the water for a split second. Several hundred images later, and I knew I'd managed at least a half sharp image, but to be honest, I didn't really care what the picture looked like. Having a family of otters playing, grooming, and sleeping so close to me while being completely unaware of my presence was really special. Every wildlife photographer has encounters with subjects that really stick in their mind for years to come, and I think this was definitely one of those.
What a cutie. The otter, not Harry. Next year, you'll be able to keep up to date with ongoing encounters like this in our new feature, Wild Diaries, so I am looking forward to that. Finally, let's hear from Nick and Marcus, who discuss their photo highlights of the year.
I have a number of what I would call photo highlights of 2020, ranging from the start of the year in the Snowdonia through to February in the Outer Hebrides, where I was co-leading our annual trip to the islands of Harris and Lewis, through to late October in the Cairngorms photographing red squirrels and the autumnal colours. However, when I was asked to choose a standout moment of 2020, one particular image instantly came to my mind. My camera bag normally consists of zoom lenses, as of course they offer me a wider range of focal lengths over a fewer amount of lenses. One such lens was a 24-70mm, which I was never completely happy with in terms of its edge-to-edge sharpness. And it was whilst out in the Outer Hebrides that I discovered the perfect replacement for this, and one which happened to be a prime lens. I borrowed Marcus's Sigma 50mm art lens and I instantly fell in love with it. So on the return to Skye, I sold my 24-70mm lens and ordered one for myself. The first time I was out with the new lens was at the Kerrang, our number 6 location in our top 10 views on Skye. The conditions were perfect, a dusting of snow on the Trottinish Ridge, great clouds filling most of the sky and breaks in cloud to the east, where of course the sun would be coming from. 20 minutes after sunrise, the sun made its way through a break in the cloud and lit up parts of the landscape in a beautiful golden light. This was the perfect time to break up my new lens, and after seeing the image pop up on the back of my camera, I knew I had something rather special.
Let's face it, 2020 isn't going to be remembered for all the international trips I went on. This year we had to cancel our annual trips to Utah, to China, to Spain, Italy, Zimbabwe and Patagonia. But all clouds do have a silver lining. And in my case, it was an increased time and opportunity to grab some of the ambitious shots that I have constantly on my mind. One such shot, which has been on my wish list for several years, is of the Old Man of Store sticking up out of the cloud. Now, I've never seen this in reality, only in my imagination, but knew it must happen occasionally. During the time when I should have been leading a workshop trip to St Kilda, I had the Fuji GFX 100 on loan for a couple of weeks, and so was looking for excuses to get out and shoot great images with it. There was a 3 or 4 day forecast for inversion layers along the Trottinish Ridge, so the first day I went to Bidabuya, our number 1 location in our top 10 views of Skye, and I got some amazing shots. But from there, you can look down the ridge and see the mountain of Store several miles to the south. You can't quite see the rocks which stick up, as these are hidden just round the corner, but I could tell the level of the cloud was almost perfect with the base of the rocks, and visualised the shot of those monoliths just standing up, almost floating in the air. It's typical, isn't it? I had the most amazing conditions, and still I'm convinced that I'm missing a better shot elsewhere. Anyway, a couple of days later, there was a similar forecast, so this time I decided to head to Store in the company of Nick and Harry. Typically, when we arrived on location, we were totally fogged in, but I knew at some point it had to break, so it was just a case of being patient. Now, I have to admit, it did take quite a lot of patience, and the thought of giving up played with me on several occasions, but I stuck with it, and as the saying goes, all good things come to those who wait. The fog suddenly cleared, leaving the pinnacles floating on a cloud exactly as I'd imagined in my mind. I don't know how often this happens, but I reckon if I had to take that shot again, it would be several years before I even got close. So for me, this was a definite standout moment of 2020.
I'm really looking forward to seeing what 2021 brings us. So that's it for another show and the first year of Photography Online. I really want to thank you for your support up to now, and I really hope you can continue to support us next year. We still have our monthly webinar, MC2 Live, which is another way you can support us as a business, so do check that out in the description too. Don't forget there's over £1,000 of prizes to be won. Did you see the Patterson box in the show? Enter the time you saw it in the link below. Give us a thumbs up if you like the show, we really appreciate it, and I'll see you next time when we'll be going to 2 shows per month. Yay! Until then, take good care, but most of all, take good photos.